And welcome to the first class on Euclidean geometry. The title of our subject. Why is it Euclidean geometry? Why is it called Euclidean and any other geometries? And what exactly we're going to study here? These are all interesting questions. So first of all, why is it called Euclidean? Euclid lived approximately at the 3rd century BC. And long before he ever existed and his school existed, ancient Egyptians and Babylonians did already use some calculations from what we call nowadays geometry to determine areas, to run their construction works and do many other things. Usually their geometry was a set of formulae or procedures that are applicable at certain situations. And of course, it was all based on measurements, and actually the second part of the word geometry comes from the Greek word metrein, which means measurements. Geo means earth measurement. That's how it starts. It starts in agriculture by measuring plots of lands. And it had been used successfully before Euclid ever existed. Why still do we call this geometry Euclidean? Let's look at some of the applications that ancient Egyptians, for instance, used. They had special clerks or officials who, on behalf of Pharaoh, would assign people plots of land, because every year all the fertile land that was located near the Nile River was inundated, and they had to cut new pieces of land, new plots of land, to the citizens according to certain Egyptian laws. And the formula they used to determine the area of a plot of land assigned to a certain person was the following. Area equals A plus C B plus D over 4. It was area, it is this way they determine the area of a quadrilateral with the sides A, B, C, and D, respectively. So one can actually check pretty easily that in case of a rectangle, this formula works just fine. If you have a rectangle, and we just use the notion of area at intuitive level as the amount of space between the boundaries of the figure, and you can split it into little squares and count how many squares are there. So all of you know it from elementary school. And if the sides of this rectangle are A, B, C, and D, you see that this formula degenerates into area equals A plus C will be 2A multiplied by B plus D. B plus D are equal sides of a rectangle, 2B, and divided by 4. And it will be just AB, the formula for the area we use for rectangles, and it looks fine. However, the question arises, will it be true for an arbitrary quadrilateral? And think about it. For an arbitrary quadrilateral, that's a big question. You can think about it. I should confess that I often ask students this question, and not very often I heard a good explanation why this formula holds or why it does not hold. usually students would proceed with so-called algebraic proof that this formula does not work. For instance, they would apply this formula to a trapezoid, for which the formula can be easily also determined by an algebraic formula, and they would discover that for a trapezoid this formula would not hold. It would be a long and not difficult but still annoying calculation. Can we solve this problem geometrically, purely geometrically? Purely geometrically? Purely geometrically. By purely geometrical means, I mean working without numbers. Actually, we are nowadays, to a great extent, we are slaves of numbers. We cannot do anything without numbers. But there was time when people tried to receive geometrical results just by mere constructions, without any numbers. It's a so-called synthetic geometry. Think about it for a second, you will be amazed that we are trying to get results without using any numbers, just by mere properties of figures in space. So think for a second, can you prove that the formula for another quadrilateral does not hold? Can you prove it geometrically? How you can prove it geometrically? I think you should show an example. If you want to disprove the formula, it would be enough to show one example where it doesn't work. And I can provide such an example. Look at this quadrilateral. This quadrilateral. I can make it different color. Exotic. This quadrilateral has some area enclosed inside it. This area, this blue square. And the area of this quadrilateral is one, whatever it is, stick squared. One stick squared. Suppose if this stick is decimeter, probably 10 centimeters, so it's one square decimeter. Now, I keep the same size because there are only sides of this quadrilateral participating in this formula. And I squash this quadrilateral. And what is the area of this quadrilateral? I can make it as small as I wish by bringing this size closer together. So eventually it will degenerate, this quadrilateral will degenerate into a segment, and the area of this will be zero. Or we can make it as close to zero as we wish. Therefore, this formula cannot work. Both figures, this original figure, a square, and the figure that into which we transformed it, they have the same sides. A, B, C's and D's present in this formula are all the same, and therefore, according to this formula, they should have had the same areas, but they do not. What's the moral of this story? The moral of this story is, when you derive formula, or use some formula, they should not come from measurements, because measurements are not reliable. Measurements are always approximate. If there is a good chance that the plots of land cut for Egyptian peasants were almost rectangular, and therefore this formula worked quite successfully. none of these officials who were losing, who were assigning plots of land, lost their head in the most direct sense what could have happened if Pharaoh knew they don't do their duty quite accurately. So this formula worked to a certain extent because it was derived phenomenologically. Phenomenological means from measurements, from observations. So deriving knowledge from observations seems to be not a very good idea, at least in many cases. How else can we derive knowledge? How else can we derive facts? Can we derive facts on which we will build our system, our knowledge? In modern science, there is the idea of axiomatic-based approach. Axioms-based approach. And that one we owe to Euclid. Actually, Euclid borrowed the idea from Aristotle that the science will be the following way. There will be some notions which we will define, so there will be definitions. Then there will be some facts that we take to be true. We believe they are true. How do we know they are true? We take them from observations. And these are the most reliable facts. And they are usually called axioms, or Euclideans call them common notions. Or postulates. When applied in a certain area of knowledge, so they're so-called specific notions. And then, by means of logic, applying logical derivations, we obtain the results of geometry. That's what the Euclidean approach was. Results. And these results are usually called propositions, the ones that can be proved, that follow from axioms. Propositions, theorems, some small auxiliary theorems are called lemmas. Some of them are even called problems. That's how Euclid and his school proposed to derive knowledge. There had been some problems, and actually, to a great extent, that's what we are doing nowadays. With only one exception. Only one exception. And in order to see what is this exception, I would like to consider some of the definitions given by Euclideans. So if you take the book by Euclid, it's called Euclid's Elements, one of the top world bestsellers. Today I listened on radio, somebody said, there is a certain person, Mr. C, he is the most quoted man for all times after Plato and Freud. And I thought, what about Euclid? This book has been reissued, re-edited, translated into all possible languages. And it's a super bestseller. It is still being translated and used in various colleges and schools. So, in particular, this English translation is quite good. It's done more than probably about 100 years ago by Thomas Heath. And I strongly recommend you, if you're going to deal with mathematics in your life, especially if you're going to teach mathematics, I strongly recommend to get this book. You can get it on Amazon or anywhere, and it's worth it. So let's turn to this book. Book one. You have this, I copied a few pages, the first pages with definitions, axioms and postulates. I copied and they are available on your blackboard, so you can see them there. So the first thing which Euclideans start is definitions. And there are definitions. Definition one, a point is that which has no part. Point is that which has no part. That's a definition number one. And we have a lot of doubts about this definition. Philosophically, it sounds pretty good. You cannot divide points into smaller parts. It's already something indivisible. But from practical viewpoint and how we can use it to construct our series, it's not clear. And also, when you give a definition, you wish that you define this object through something that is already known. And the notion of part is also actually quite a geometrical notion. We don't have a definition of this one. Definition number two. A line is a breadthless length. I have doubts about this as well, because the breadth or the width of something is a notion that requires definition. How can we define lines through the things that we don't know? Breadth and length. These are also geometrical notions, and they're not easy notions. In order to define what is the length of a segment, we will jump through many hoops. You will see it's a lot of trouble to do this. And there are many other definitions like this. Let's notice the following, that very often by the word line, Euclideans meant a curve, what we call a curve nowadays, and then there is a later definition. A straight line is a line which lies evenly with the points on itself. That's definition number four. A straight line, it's worth writing it. A straight line is a line, because by word line he actually means a curve, is a line which lies evenly with the points on itself. Which lies evenly with the points on itself. That's the idea. Yes? This does not lie evenly with the points on itself. This point, with respect to this point, is located kind of differently than this point with respect to this point, right? You can see it. Whether on the line, it sounds pretty fair. All the points lie evenly, except of course I recall another curve, because in Euclidean's line is a curve, which also lies evenly with the points on itself, what we call a circle. It also lies even. All the points with respect to each other are located absolutely evenly. So, is it a good straight line? It is not. So, some of these definitions are not very good. And whereas others are really good definitions, much better ones than given in your high school courses, and there are really, really good definitions which worth reading. So I ask you to read all of these definitions and consider them critically and think about them. Some of these definitions have obsolete terminology. For instance, nobody calls quadrilaterals trapeziums anymore. Yes? So you can just ignore this one. But otherwise, it's very interesting, these definitions. For instance, I can tell you that nowadays you can often hear in geometrical courses in school, they define a right angle as an angle of 90 degrees. So they appeal to numbers, which is already a very mean trick. Moreover, they appeal to degrees, which require also definition. And whether it's Euclideans, they have a very good definition. They have the only possible right definition of a right angle. These are definitions you will see. I don't want to rewrite it all because it is very long, but it's number 10, 11, and 12. It tells the following, that if a line, how they call it, set up on a straight line, it's another line, and they make these angles alpha and beta, these are called adjacent angles. Two sides extend each other into a straight line, and one side is common for this angle. Such angles are called adjacent. So if one of them is less than the other, then alpha is called an acute angle, and beta is called an obtuse angle. And if alpha is congruent to beta, congruent is geometric notion of equivalence, being the same. If they are equal angles, you can say equal angles, then each of them is called a right angle. That's a good definition. You don't have to reduce to numbers. And this is purely geometrical definition. So, I would ask you to look at these definitions, to read them, think about them critically. And what is this deficiency that we can see right away in this approach? That there is an attempt to define everything. And define everything is, I think, even just philosophically is impossible, because we have to define new objects through the objects we already know. And therefore, in modern approach to geometry, we come to an idea that there are so-called undefined notions. I would even call them undefinable, because you cannot define them. So first thing we know, there must be undefined notions. So if they're undefined, what do we know about them? We cannot define them. We still know, we may know how to deal with them from observing their properties. And their properties are described in, again, Aristotelians and Euclid also called this statement that we believe to be true axioms, when they're applied in common, in general knowledge, or postulates for a specific area of knowledge. Nowadays, these two words considered to be complete synonyms, because when we develop certain area of knowledge, it becomes part of general knowledge. So it's described in axioms or postulates. We will not distinguish between these two. Euclideans did distinguish between them. For instance, they would say a whole, for them, axiom would be a whole is greater than its part. Sounds very reasonable. I would tell you which one it is. It is a common notion number five. It is a common notion number five. Or things which are equal to the same thing are also equal to one another. It's a common notion number one. If A is equal to B and B is equal to C, then it follows that A is equal to C. And we gladly assume this common notion. Of course, we use it in our activities, in our scientific activities, and we will use them in this course as well. What about the postulates? Euclideans also had a set of postulates. I will not list all of them. You will see they're quite reasonable assumptions of how things work in general. These are common notions. For Euclidean, axioms were common notions. What about the postulates? They're also on this one of these pages that I gave you, and it's interesting how Euclideans formulate geometrical postulates. They usually formulate them in terms of possible constructions. So, postulate number one: to draw a straight line from any point to any point. To draw a straight line from any point to any point. So what this axiom tells us? The axiom tells us that if there is a point and there is another point, so we can draw a straight line that connects these points. By the way, you will notice in this book, when they say a straight line, they actually mean a straight segment which can be extended. It's a special postulate that this segment can be extended to a straight line. Nowadays we just say straight line is infinitely long, something like this. Actually, this postulate postulates the existence of a tool. This tool called a straight edge. But by this reason, this postulate is often called a straight edge postulate. It postulates the existence of such tool that allows us to join. So these postulates are formulated as constructions. To produce a finite straight line continuously in a straight line. So it's all about this tool. It's number three. To describe a circle with any center and distance. To describe a circle with any center and distance. Actually, we have a special thing for such a procedure. We have a special thing, it's called a compass, and it allows us to draw a circle, and it's not very easy because it is a whiteboard, the compass is sliding, but you saw the procedure, how it's done. I better draw a circle like this. Suppose we suggest this is the center, and we can stick one leg of the compass in this point, at this point, and draw around it a circle with the center at this point, all and radius the given segment R. And they postulated the existence of such a tool. By the way, Euclideans postulated the existence of a compass, so it's called a compass postulate. The compass that was used by Euclideans at that time was a so-called collapsing compass. What means collapsing compass? That when they give me a segment, they say this is segment R, and I want you to draw a circle with a centered point O. And what happened if I have this ancient Greek compass? I measure this segment R, I want it to be my radius. And as soon as I removed the legs of the compass from this position, it collapses. So I forgot what is R, I go back to R again. It collapses again, so I cannot bring it here and actually draw a circle. But you can try to prove, and Euclideans did prove it, that with a collapsing compass you can do exactly the same constructions as with our modern compass that keeps the distance between the legs whenever you need it. My compass keeps this distance, you can bring it here and you can draw a circle. So you can prove that collapsing compass allows you to do the same operations. Number four postulates that all right angles are equal to one another. That's a big mystery about this postulate. Number four. All right angles are equal to one another. All right angles are equal. So what that means is that if you draw a right angle here, you draw a right angle here, they are equal. Actually, the people who studied history of science, and especially the history of Euclidean geometry, suggested this was taken as an axiom in order to postulate the existence of what we call nowadays rigid motion. Suppose it's made of cardboard and I can take this piece of plane and move it in such a way that A goes to point B. And then I can rotate this right angle and they will coincide completely. This right angle will fall exactly on this right angle. That's probably what Euclideans wanted to say. So they wanted to postulate the existence of so-called rigid motions. Most likely, we don't know what was in their minds, but most likely there is no other reason to take it as an axiom, because if we have a reasonable set of axioms, as you see, you will be able to prove that all right angles are equal. And if you can prove something, you don't take it as an axiom. What else? Postulate number five. You will read it yourself. I can read it, but I will not write it because it takes a lot of time to write. That if a straight line falling on two straight lines makes the interior angles on the same side less than two right angles, then the two straight lines, if produced indefinitely, meet on that side on which the angles less than two right angles. So I will just formulate it briefly. Suppose there are two straight lines, L1 and L2, and another line falls on them, so as to make interior angles, this angle and this angle, alpha and beta, less than two right angles, alpha plus beta. I will a convention less than 180 degrees, which is customary for you. In the future, we will avoid numbers by all means until certain moment when we really introduce real numbers and we will be able to measure things. So if these two lines are produced, they will meet somewhere at a point on that side of the line where alpha plus beta is less than 180. It will not, they will not meet on this other side. Yeah? They will meet here. And this is postulate number 5. Which seemed to be so clearly following from other postulates. So people tried to prove this postulate coming from the first 4 postulates for 2000 years. Eventually, 2 mathematicians independently, Lobachevsky and Balyai, came with the idea to prove the independence of the 5th postulate. So they have proved that postulate 5 does not follow from the other postulate, it is independent. And actually nowadays we know it is a postulate that gives Euclidean geometry its Euclidean title. Because they proved the independence of this postulate by constructing another geometry, so-called hyperbolic geometry. Hyperbolic geometry. Or by names of the authors Lobachevsky, Balyai. In hyperbolic geometry, the parallel lines behave differently than Euclidean geometry. And there are many, it creates many strange features, and this is strange from our common viewpoint. Actually, the world in which we live is a hyperbolic world, but it's approximately Euclidean. So, in hyperbolic geometry, there are many interesting things. The angle sum in the triangle is not 180 degrees. Rectangles do not exist. There is more than one line you can draw parallel to a given line through a given point. And so on and so on. We will not consider hyperbolic geometry. But for a long while, in the first, I shouldn't say quarter, maybe first quarter or first third of the course, we will consider the so-called neutral geometry. And this neutral geometry will consist of results which are based on the first 4 postulates of Euclidean geometry. And then, if you add to neutral geometry Euclidean 5th postulate, the result will be the Euclidean geometry. If you add to this geometry, let's say, hyperbolic parallel postulate, as a result you will receive the so-called hyperbolic geometry. So, we will spend substantial amount of time studying neutral geometry without applying the parallel postulate, any parallel postulate, because it is important to know which results will be true both in hyperbolic and Euclidean geometry. So, it's always important for us to know what our area of knowledge consists of, what were the assumptions from which we have obtained our results. And you will see that plenty of of substantial results which you studied, for instance, in high school. Some of you studied, some of you did not. They are true in both in Euclidean and hyperbolic geometry. I would say we will stop here with the first part of our class. So what is it we learned here? What is Euclidean geometry about? We still don't know what is Euclidean geometry about, because it will be very important also to define what we mean by equivalence, what we mean by congruence. As we know now, there is more than one geometry. And what determines the geometry is the notion of congruence applied in this geometry, the axiom that underlies it. Next time we will start with our axioms that we are going to use. It will be a more modern set than the ones used by Euclideans, because Euclideans used physical motion. They did not say how to make right angles, how to combine them together. So they suggested, and they used in many proofs, that physical rigid motions exist, motions that do not change shape of objects exist. And we will propose a slightly more rigorous set of axioms. And then we will start deriving our results. But so far what we know is that Euclidean geometry is valuable because it is axiom based, and that's how we derive precise knowledge. That's a real knowledge. Of course, this knowledge will be as good as our axioms. If we change a set of axioms, we will get a different theory, and it happened in the history of humankind a few times. People were building their physics, classical physics, based on Newtonian axioms of motion, and then it turned out at the end of 19th, beginning of 20th century, that this theory is not completely consistent, and they have been replaced with more precise axioms of special relativity. Yes, and instead of adding velocity by the law v1 plus v2 will be the sum of two velocities, it turns out you have to add them by the law v1 plus v2